tonight. I'm so glad that you were able to come and join me for my lecture recital on Debussy and his Sonata for Violin and Piano. I would like to give a special thank you to a couple people, the first being my collaborative pianist, Professor Susan Hoskins, for her talent and patience and time dedicated in helping me prepare this semester for this day. And also, I would like to thank Professor Schwartz for his devoting his time and knowledge and talents and helping me become a better musician and teaching me more about this fascinating piece. Tonight, I would like to discuss a couple things, including Debussy's childhood life, as well as the effects of his global travels, the political and global turmoil that he endured, and lastly, his health struggles had on his works. So Debussy's official birth name was Achille Claude Debussy, and he was born in August of 1862 in Saint-Germain-en-Laye, located in the western suburbs of Paris. He was not born into a family of wealth, nor a musical one. François Lejour's book, simply titled Claude Debussy, states that, quote, "There is no mystery about the family's origins, as he stemmed from the purest peasant stock, their becoming modest craftsmen or small shopkeepers could hardly be described as moving up in society. There was not even the faintest glimmer of a family member awakening to an artistic calling." Debussy's grandfather was a carpenter and a wine merchant, and Debussy's father, Manuel Achille, spent 7 years in the Marines. His mother, Victorine Monroy, was the daughter of a cook, and once Manuel and Victorine were married, they settled in Saint-Germain-en-Laye, where they sold pottery and eventually raised their family. However, Victorine later left her husband and took her two sons, Manuel and Achille Claude, to Paris to live with her sister, who was home taking care of Victorine's daughter, Adele. Clementine, the aunt, was the one who sought out his talent as a musician, although teachers who heard him play and worked with him just described him as an ordinary student and an ordinary musician. Claude was not even 10 years old when he experienced his first taste of political unrest, as his father, Manuel Debussy, was back in Saint-Germain fighting the Franco-Prussian War as a captain. However, things later became dangerous as the insurrection of the Commune occurred, which was a revolutionary socialist government that defied the French government and ruled Paris from March 18th through May 28th of 1871. It occurred in the wake of France's defeat in the Franco-Prussian War and the collapse of Napoleon III's Second Empire, which existed from 1852 to 1870. Manuel was sent to the front lines, and after being accused of participating in the Commune, he was arrested, incarcerated, and eventually stripped of all family and civil rights. However, one positive event to come out of his incarceration was the fact that he connected his son, Claude, with a teacher that would get him into the French Conservatory. Charles de Sivry was a self-taught musician, and he befriended Manuel and shared that his mother, Antoinette, was a piano teacher who claimed to be a student of Chopin's. Sivry convinced Manuel to entrust Claude into the care of Antoinette in order to train for the conservatory, into which he was accepted. And on the slide here, you can see this is a photo of Manuel Debussy. Many years later, Debussy would find himself facing another war, this time on even a greater scale. On August 1st of 1914, the French military started to mobilize to fight in World War I. Debussy loved Paris and felt very sorry he could not do more to help. He wrote to his publisher, Jacques Durand, that he was envious of fellow composer Erik Satie, quote, "who will have an important job defending Paris in his capacity as a corporal." On August 31st, as the Germans had become increasingly close to Paris, Debussy's wife, Emma, begged him to leave with the children. Debussy was able to get a safe conduct pass a couple days later, and they left Paris for Angers, France, which was around 165 miles away, which is pictured on the slide. On the trip, trip, Debussy was able to sketch the music for his work Pour la Note Répétesse, which became the ninth in a series of his future etudes. However, the effects of the war took a toll on both his mental and physical well-being and diminished his ability to compose more than a couple works at a time. He spent a period of 18 months in what he described as a factory of nothingness. But this changed, however, in 1915, and he developed a renewed vigor and commitment to music and composing. He was extremely productive, and in Marion Wieldon's book, Debussy's Late Style, it states that Debussy wrote to friend Robert Godet that, quote, "I rediscovered my ability to think in music. It's the only thing I know how to do, more or less well. And I confess its disappearance has made me miserable. Anyway, I've been working like a madman, or like a man who is condemned to die the next morning." This new way of thinking, in turn, had an effect on his compositional style. He began to write small piano works and chamber works, such as Sonata for Cello and Harp, or his Sonata for Flute, Viola, and Harp. He also used more traditional titles for his pieces, which allowed for artistic expression and liberties. The movements of his violin sonata, for example, are tempo markings, such as Allegro vivo. But in contrast, the movements of his famous orchestral work, La Mer, can be translated to From Dawn to Noon on the Sea, Play of the Waves, and Dialogue of the Wind and Sea. Wieldon's book also points out how we find Debussy renouncing the dramatic, the poetic, and the exotic for an entirely more traditional set of genres. However, another unfortunate change in Debussy's life also occurred in the same year of 1915. His health began to decline, and Debussy was eventually diagnosed with rectal cancer. Surgery proved to be unsuccessful, and the combination of his diagnosis, his financial issues, and the political climate of the time caused Debussy to fall into a depression. He was, however, surrounded by family and friends who wrote and visited his home often. He passed away March 25th of 1918 at the age of 55. The work I will be performing this evening, his Sonata for Violin and Piano, was the last work that he composed, and it was the third of a set of six sonatas he intended to write, preceded by his Sonata for Cello and Piano, and his Sonata for Flute, Cello, and Harp. And was to be followed by his Sonata number 4 for oboe, French horn, and harpsichord, number 5 for clarinet, bassoon, trumpet, and piano, and number 6, which would have united all the instruments from the preceding 5, flute, oboe, clarinet, bassoon, French horn, trumpet, violin, viola, cello, piano, harp, and harpsichord, to which he also planned to add the double bass. He wrote this sonata in 1917, 3 years after France had entered World War I, and wrote to his friend, quote, "I only wrote this sonata to be rid of it, spurred on by my dear publisher. This sonata will be interesting from a documentary point of view, as an example of what an ailing man can produce in time of war." Dr. David Grayson, a professor of musicology at the University of Minnesota, is an expert on Debussy and his music, and he graciously shared his thoughts on this particular work. He states that this sonata simply befits our current bleak times. But Debussy also offers us distraction, relief, and hope, which we need above all, even if it comes from a dark place. As Debussy wrote of his sonata on another occasion, quote, "By a very human contradiction, it is full of joyous tumult. Beware in the future of words that seem to soar high in the sky. Often they have languished in the darkness of a gloomy brain." He also points out, Dr. Grayson also points out that in his mind, the project of six sonatas responded to a number of pressures. Number one, to find an alternative to theater works, such as opera, ballet, and incidental music, because of wartime restrictions. Two, to move in a neoclassical direction as an antidote to the disorder and insanity of war. Three, to find some controllable activity to occupy his mind while suffering the ravages of a debilitating disease, and lastly, to avoid comparison with Stravinsky, who had overtaken him in the vanguard of new music. The cellular idea for this work came to him on a walk in Iraq and France, but he found it an extremely difficult task to compose the ending. We can see from one of Debussy's letters to friend Paul Dukas, this particular piece caused him turmoil and stress. He writes, quote, "I am between 1,000 worries and 12 ways to finish a sonata for violin and piano." He based the structure not on the popular sonata form, but on the chamber music of 18th century France. The intimacy and dance rhythms further illuminate this musical heritage. The premiere of this work took place on May 5th, 1917, at a benefit concert for blind soldiers at the Salle Gaveau, which is pictured here. Debussy had intended for the premiere of this work to be performed by violinist Arthur Hartman, an American violinist of Hungarian descent. However, the work was performed at the premiere by violinist Gaston Poulet and was accompanied by Debussy himself. Composer Poulenc also attended this event and wrote that Debussy received a warm greeting to the stage, but the work itself was only met with barely courteous, half-filled applause at the end, and Debussy himself stated that his vocal composition, which translates to the Christmas Carol of the Children Who No Longer Have Homes, received far more attention and enthusiasm from the audience than his sonata. In this work, we can see many of Debussy's influences. Scottish violinist Nicola Benedetti stated in an interview with Strings Magazine that, quote, "My memory of trying to interpret Debussy was, how can I sound as far away from a normal violin player as possible? I later learned more about Debussy's influences and how he looked outside his culture, and not just European culture, but absolutely worldwide." One influence we can clearly hear in this sonata is Spanish folk music. Manuel de Falla wrote an essay regarding this topic. I believe Debussy successfully assimilated and permeated his works with the essence of Spanish music and Spanish folk song. Debussy's work, Iberia for Orchestra, was inspired by Spanish music, and we hear influences of this work in his sonata for violin and piano as well. He was also influenced by Russian classical music, and Saminsky describes Debussy as a spiritual son of Mussorgsky and Rimsky-Korsakov. In addition, he was influenced by the Japanese gamelan, which he had first heard at the Paris World Exhibition. Although he was already familiar with pentatonic and whole tone scales in his works, he was especially interested in the rhythmic complexities of the gamelan and the effects they produced. The first movement of his sonata for violin and piano, which is titled Allegro Vivo, develops out of two very serene and simple chords on the piano, which will be demonstrated here. The Listeners Club describes this opening, stating, quote, "Moving from G minor to C major, each of these chords seems to come from its own distinct expressive universe. Taken together, they seem to suggest openness and endless possibility. With the entrance of the violin, the piece is thrillingly unpredictable and mercurial drama begins to unfold. We move abruptly from turbulence to celestial serenity and back again." The texture of this first movement is thin and sparse. The mood is both fatigued and agitated. Later, we have multi-octave arpeggios in the piano that give a sense of spaciousness, evoking the waves of the sea which forever inspired Debussy. His mastery of tonal color is evident in the variety of violin articulations and textures in the piano. As stated earlier, he was enamored by this when he went to the Paris World Exhibition. And we hear influences of the Japanese gamelan expressed through the pentatonic scales, which we will demonstrate now. Influences of Spanish music and folk song at the end of this movement through the guitar-like chords in the piano as well as the modal scales that I play on violin. Intermedia, fantastique et légère, blends the capricious and vivacious feeling of a scherzo with moments of haunting introspection. In the final bars, the music gives us a perfectly convincing resolution to C major, only to slide down to G major for the true resolution. There's a magical sense that harmony itself is floating through an ephemeral sea. The Cleveland Chamber Music website writes about this movement, stating, quote, "The second movement, with its staccato burst and pizzicato, provides a jaunty contrast to the first. Smear notes in the violin mimic fiddlers. It has a silly type character compared to the likes of Pierrot or to Lückenspiegel by Strauss. Pierrot, as pictured on the slide, was a popular pantomime character who was described as mocking, sly, greedy, and rascal, to name a few. Professor Hoskins and I will perform a clip from this movement that I feel best represents this character. Also has Spanish influence. The flute line in the second movement of Iberia has a similar lazy, meandering feel that the violin has in the second movement of this sonata. Strings magazine points out the short glissandos in the second and third movements suggest the influence of violinist Bayoradix, whose playing Debussy once heard in a Budapest nightclub. The final movement, finale, Très animé, opens with a return to the main theme of the first movement. Filled with mystery, the theme now seems to be opening the door to a new transcendent world. The LA Phil's program notes on this movement state that, quote, "The introduction to the third movement, a twinkling piano tremolo passage against the violin's reinstatement as black as the night sky of the work's first theme, is grossly incongruous with the material immediately before and after it. It stands as a reminder that despite this work's feigned jocularity, it is the work of a man acutely aware of the pain of death." As stated earlier, in a letter, Debussy described the violin sonata as, quote, "filled with tumultuous joy." We get a sense of the true meaning of this statement. Strings Magazine notes in the final moments that one should listen for the extraordinary passage in which a motivic fragment in the violin spins off into a new episode. By one of those very human contradictions, for Debussy, the finale is full of happiness and uproar. Of the frequent shift in tempo, key, and mood, he added, quote, "It goes through the most curious contortions before ending up with a simple idea which turns back on itself like a snake biting its own tail, an amusement whose attractions I take leave to doubt. It has been a wonderful experience to study this piece this semester, and I hope you enjoyed our performance of Debussy's Sonata for Violin and Piano. Thank you." Thank you.